So little birdie just told me that you guys want to see part two of this kind of bombastic countdown. And by little birdie, I mean the newest mascot, the gnome. AKA the gnome from Little Nightmares is now working for me. Well, one of them anyway. Or I think five? Maybe five? I don't know. Let's go hop back into the countdown at number five. Segway music and montage now. Coming in at number five, we have the producer's song, Keep It Gay.
Whether it's murder, mayhem, or rage, don't complain, it's a pain, keep it gay.
For this choice, I'm only going to basically have this whole entire thing be brought to you guys in the simplest way I could. How do you try to revitalize a terrible musical on purpose to make it seem very awful and motivate your entire cast and crew? Basically, this song points it out. You gotta keep it light, keep it friendly, but most importantly, keep it gay. And I don't mean like that whole happy, the actual term for gay. The musical is very blatant, saying you need to have it with a very homosexual affair and tone with it. That way the cadence of it kind of goes in the whole, woo, I'm here, bitches. Let's have a musical. Let's have it wild. Let's have it fantabulous. But most importantly, we're keeping it gay. Also, it doesn't help the fact that The Producers is probably one of the greatest movies and musicals that people have seen far and wide, of just trying to see two bumbling idiots make a bad musical for bankruptcy. Honestly, those guys would be my heroes, just trying to actually make a terrible musical on purpose. But why is this at number five, though? Is what a lot of people are wondering, because of the whole energy and vibe I'm giving to this. Well, that's only because, aside from just the whole vibrant energy and how it tries to make it seem so intensely wonderful, it doesn't have that whole emotional tether that I have with other songs on this list than other sort of mentions of it. It's a good song. It's one of mine and my big sister Shweeby's favorite songs from an amazing musical that even I enjoy. But it's kind of keeping it off the shelf for numbers 4-1. Coming in at number 4, we have probably one of the oldest musicals that I actually saw on one of its European tours back when I was a young lad with my grandparents when they were alive. So this is gonna be a very emotional talking while I'm doing this entry. Memory from Cats. Now, it's been years since I've seen the Broadway production, so the plot is kind of hazy for myself until I did some research a few minutes ago before we started this recording session, where it's basically the story of these jubilant cats in a dark alley in, I think, New York City, trying to decide which one of them is worthy enough to basically die and become reborn as something entirely different. They acknowledge the fact that in an earlier song that they know that there's a fourth wall that's being broken to see the audience, or at least one singular man. But that's beside the point. The song itself of Memory being sang by a character by the name of Grisabella, who is a glamour cat that's shunned by her entire feline family for just trying to see the world. And there are multiple interpretations with this song, but personally for myself, after going through various life-changing events, I see this song as basically trying to hold on to at least some sort of attachment to those that you've left behind while trying to find and discover new things about yourself, trying to discover who you are as a being while also trying to at least see where it is that you've come from and how much that you've grown. where everything about the whole sadness about how much the people that you've loved and lost, but how much you're trying to gain for yourself over bigger and better moves for yourself, are starting to culminate into how much the wedge has been driven in, and every single bridge that seems burnt can still be recovered. I could go all day with this, but I really don't feel like crying, because this was probably one of the best memories I've had with my grandparents that I want to keep holding on to because of how light it is. So I'll at least just say why it's not at the top three. It's an amazing song. It's beautifully sung. Every player that does this is incredible, I will admit, but not as good as the 81 player, Miss Betty. I will admit that. But as I've grown into my own secular taste in the things, I don't really see much beauty in certain things like that. Although it does still hit me in a very soft place whenever I hear songs from the musical Cats, because it just still wells up emotions inside of myself that I will never, ever have washed away. So as much as I enjoy this, number four, you gotta at least stay a happy, warm memory for me. You can't ascend any higher. Coming in at number three, we have probably the most awkwardly weird entry that most people could never have imagined. Repo the Genetic Opera's Zydrate Anatomy.
Zydrate comes in a little glass vial.
A little glass vial?
A little glass vial.
And the little glass vial goes into the gun like a battery.
I'm not even gonna bullshit and act like I remember anything about this musical. I don't remember a goddamn thing anymore. Basically, it's a very dark gothic musical that has a lot of things going on and a lot of tropes and storylines that even I can't remember to this date because I haven't seen the movie in years. But I will always remember this song because of how bombastically awesome it is. Now, for a song that's basically about signing a contract with a group full of weirdos that also do certain things of surgery, anatomy changes, and a whole assortment of other things that kind of go into the quote-unquote signing illegal deals to make musical dreams come true while also trying to not be caught up by the police that want to enslave those that do illegal surgeries on others. It's quite frankly I wouldn't say a terrible production song, I will say it's memorable, but it's very odd, in the best fucking way possible. This isn't really helping my case due to my terrible memory with this musical, but I will admit it does still hit me in an I want to party with ravers mood, which is something a lot of songs don't do these days. But why is it only at number three? If Cats was more profound, and if the producers was so much more rejuvenated and more fun and more energetic. Basically, I will put it to you guys like this. If you were to hear a song that you haven't heard in a long time from like a movie you haven't seen in decades, or a musical in general, to keep to the topic, that you haven't seen in a long time, and you just hear that one song, it doesn't really matter at the end of the day, because you'll just all of a sudden have that same intense feeling of attachment that you had the same moment you heard this song. No matter how it comes up, no matter how it's presented, you'll just be that one person rocking out to it, even if your friends are just like, what the hell is this? And you're just like, it's my time, bitch. Let me be me. But once again, I'm just going to leave it at only number three because, although personally I like it, I will admit that in the entire tapestry of the film and musical that are bounded to this song, it's kind of woven in kind of flimsily from certain regards. Coming in at number two, we have not only my favorite song from a movie I've loved for years, not only from a musical that I myself love as a non-musical fan, but from one of my favorite stories of all time. Joanna Reprise, from Sweeney Todd, Demon Barber of Fleet Street. And yes, I will be using footage from the movie. Not the musical, not the off-Broadway musical. From the movie.
We learned Joanna to say.
Now, there are a lot of emotions that are being tied together with this one particular song, many of which I could go into in length, but I'm saving all that stuff for the review I have planned for Sweeney Todd coming out in 2019. Until then, what is it about this one song that hits me really hard the most? It's because it happened to hit me on two sides in two different parts of my life. When I saw it in the musical Broadway production, I felt myself more attached to the sailor that was trying to chase after Joanna because that was his true love. That's who he wanted to be with at first sight. He wanted to basically wow her, to woo her, to take her away from this dark place in London and just have a free life. But as I've gotten older, I felt more attached to how Sweeney Todd feels because as of late, since I now have more and more responsibilities and I don't hear from my own eldest anymore, I often sometimes feel as if I can not really see or hear from my own daughter at all anymore. It sends me in this whole unique spiral inside my own mind where I'm just often wondering, what the hell am I gonna do? How can I cope with this whole sadness, and can I move on the more things go on in my life? It's a giant duality process that kind of hits me at a big enough psyche where anything that comes at me, I often have to just be like, huh, that is an interesting way to see things now, brain, thank you, and move on with certain steps. That's what this song in particular has done to me in a positive and sometimes negative light if you were to take into certain connotations. But we'll go into that at a later date in a psychological evaluation. So, for the entirety, that's why it's number two above a lot of other songs, because the whole biggest attachment to myself as a person, where I can see myself in the younger days and myself currently having a clashing ideals of what's more important, which is something a lot of people need to know about something that they're attached to. But it's not number one because it has to go so far beyond my own personal attachment that I can take on new lights for myself to see something that can pretty much make me want to surpass it in certain lengths as not only a being of creation for stuff involving the arts, but also someone that tries to see higher heights for myself in the ideals and ideas brought to me from another sort of spectrum. That is why this is only going to stay at number two. Although I will admit the reprise for Joanna was beautiful, but number transition. Before we get into number one, I thought I would do something really nice for all the musicals that didn't get into this countdown and just do a rundown of posters of the musicals that were honorable mentions on this list.
When I die, I'm a god, paint me large on the wall. When I die, I'm a god, paint me large on the wall. When I die, I'm a god, paint me large on the wall. When I die, I'm a god, paint me large on the wall.
You on the wall. Legend never fall. You on the wall. Made this legend never fall. Made this legend never fall. You on the.
Now then, here we are finally at number one, everyone. Can we all take a guess about what dear old Uncle V has in store for you all? Could it be hair? Could it be Jesus Christ Superstar? Oh, I know. You guys are obviously thinking that it's obviously, the color purple because I brought it up in part one. Surprise, surprise, it is not any of those things that you all thought it was. I have to be like this because I have to be super fucking hype because this is probably one of the greatest musicals that I've ever seen in production when it was on Broadway. Ladies and gentlemen, at number one we have not only Masquerade, but Why So Silent from the Broadway musical / kind of crappy but also kind of decent film, Phantom of the Opera.
Why so silent, good monsieur? Did you think that I had left you for good?
Now that I got my hype man out so that you guys got it all on the ground, let me go into why these two songs combined make number one. Masquerade is a very joyous song about how the entire opera is celebrating the surprising success for Christina and her beau, and all the success and glamour they've gotten from all of their cast players and whatnot for the entirety of the opera season. But it's also interrupted and intersected by none other than the song of Why So Silent from the Phantom himself, of Eric the Phantom. Never really got a last name in the translations I got, because I really failed to see the book in its entirety, but I'll get to that another day. Why So Silent often is referred to as a good interloping song into how to change the tone and cadence of how the events and atmosphere of the entire whatever story you're trying to do act in a concise manner. The way it kind of has a juxtaposition from a joyous celebratory tone into a menacing, cold, hard chill for everyone, just the drop of a single note, even if you were to do it with just simple words, where just the Phantom himself appears out of nowhere, no music whatsoever, as if it was just a regular old film or play of some sorts, it can still have that whole chilling tone going from a joyous event into something that is completely catastrophic to anyone's own mind. From that whole intersecting ideals and ideas, you have so much to work with when you have something of this caliber towards yourself. And that is aside from all the other songs that come from Phantom of the Opera that many other people feel attached to. Like Angel of Music being a nice little touch on how someone that really did miss their parents of any sort, being mother or father or sometimes grandparent, feel like they want to have some sort of comfort and have some sort of balance in their own hearts and souls over how they should or shouldn't carry themselves. It goes into those sort of lengths that not a lot of people tend to appreciate until they have those sort of small little ideals of seeing how far creativity can go, which is what these songs have done. As a creator myself for a lot of stuff involving many different things in media, I always try to look into songs that try to overreach the boundaries of what can and cannot be creative. These two are obviously high points into what I want to do creatively, which is why this is a combinative whole is why it's number one. And it's not really cheating because it's from the same exact musical that's the same transition song from one to the other, making its own little intermingling sort of chain, where if you just had one part, it's not complete without the other, making its own complete song, even though they're two different titles. Well, guys, that is all I'm saying about musicals, and man, I'm gonna burn the script now, because I cannot write as good as all of my friends. But I would like to thank you all for joining me on this entire adventure, and for helping me see this whole thing through, and I'll see you guys in my next countdown, which you probably might get a hint about if you were to subscribe and become a nomad today. We like to have a good time, like to have a fun time, but most importantly, we just like to have an encouraging, beautiful time. Until next time.
Are you one of those so-called badasses?